In the west end of Toronto, there's a little wedge of land called the Junction Triangle. Its borders are defined by the railway tracks that surround it. These very same rail lines will determine the neighborhood's future. This is where I live with my wife and daughter. And for the time being, this is what it looks like if you walk around really fast.
It's an important story, for no matter who you are, where you are, or what you do, the railroads influence your life and the way you live.
Electric trains are better though, because they don't make you run flat like diesels and cigarette butts.
And do you know how many diesel trains are going to come through here every day?
Six. Two. Four.
Well, keep going. Up, up, up. Keep counting.
Ten.
A lot more.
12.
A lot more.
150. 170. 177.
464 trains will be coming right along here every single day.
Following my weekly injection for allergies associated with asthma. So I'm going to my trusted doctor to have a single injection.
We keep that in one injection, not two.
Oh, sure.
Great. It's like this. There you are.
Thank you.
Oh,
yet another.
That was easy.
Another fine injection, yes.
So you've been doing this 7 years, you say?
Yes.
So how many needles do you think you would have given Nikki in 7 years?
All right. Let's say 50 needles per year, 50 times 7, 350 needles so far. Yeah, that's a number, isn't it?
That's a lot of needles.
In 2007, the Ontario government formed an agency called Metrolinx. Its job was to oversee public transit expansion in the Toronto and Hamilton region and to govern GO, our public transit operator. One of the first big projects for Metrolinx is the expansion of the Georgetown Rail Corridor. The Georgetown Line is the main artery that will carry the trains to their various destinations, including the rail link to Toronto's International Airport. Currently, there are 49 diesel trains a day using the line. That number will soon climb to over 450. The increased traffic will engulf the Junction Triangle. So no matter which way the wind blows, 9,000 residents in the neighborhood will be inhaling diesel exhaust.
And the government just continued to invest in diesel technology because oil was cheap. At that time, air quality issues were not a major concern. The freight railways really didn't want to deal with electrification in their rail corridors. But even back in those days, we were looking at the inevitability of us possibly electrifying. The problem I think that's happened is we're at a point now in time where if you look at electrifying the system, it is a very big expense.
One of the things I found really interesting was in an early meeting, one of the GO representatives said that first he felt that electrification was inevitable, and he also remarked that this was a topic that was brought up every 5 to 10 years, and that GO Transit had studied the issue on multiple occasions, and each time had basically concluded that it was too expensive to embark on. And meanwhile, every decade that passed, the cost, of course, went up and up, and so by quite a considerable factor. And so this is a conversation that's been happening for 40 years at GoTransit, not really realizing that if it's nipped in the bud and it's solved now, we're not just perpetuating this cycle of increasing expense and sort of forcing the next generation to have to deal with a problem that we're unwilling to address today.
But this is a modern age.
And I suppose railroads aren't modern.
Well, maybe I don't know enough about railroads.
Maybe. You and a lot of other people.
I see. I never noticed this before. Well, this is really exposed. This is great. Well, the interesting thing is that the railways were here first. And it was, in a way, you can say that the railways is the reason there is a neighborhood here. It's the railways that attracted the business to this area, the industry. And it was the industry that attracted the people. Because workers used to live near where they worked. And so when industry came, workers followed. This was the old Glidden paint factory. It closed in the early 90s, I believe. And it was one of the companies that neighborhood groups were concerned about. There was tension between the company and residents over pollution issues.
We went to City Hall to protest Glidden. They wanted to expand their factory without any input from the neighborhood. They passed it at City Hall. We had a very raucous meeting there. We came home very disgruntled because they had allowed them to do this. And apparently about 2 a.m, there was a horrendous spill. So I got up to get my children ready for school, and they went off. And I felt very dizzy, and I thought, gee, I can't go to work. And I lay down on the couch, and next thing I know, my kids are back. And I said, what are you doing back here? Oh, they sent us home because there's been a terrible spill. They're not allowing anyone to come out of their house smoking. They have police cars, and the fumes were coming out of the sewers. And so that night, we had the mayor and everyone from the media down to talk about this. So they rescinded that move that night.
If you came over to my place and looked out the back window, this is what you'd see. This is our neighborhood, and these are some neighbors.
Aggie, Anik, Ann, Asha, Benoit, Connor, Al, Finnegan, Fanny B, who's almost 2, Jerry, Amina, Jack, Kelly, Kenneth, Kevin, Kristen, Lisa, Marcel, Maddie, Rosie, Scott, Sebastian, Shenanigan, Simone, Terry, Tessa, my best friend, Victoria, William, and me.
And that's Nellie Noodles, who's 5 3/4. She is my sensitive receptor.
When you do a risk assessment, you're doing it based on receptor. And receptor is just another sort of scientific neutral name actually for person. So you're imagining where a person might live or work or play. That's the receptor, and that location is put into the model. So that helps with how far does that receptor live or work or play in relation to where the train line is proposed. The idea of sensitive has to do with who in the population is more sensitive. So sensitive probably would imply children, or it may imply seniors who might have some underlying health problems.
The Junction Triangle is just getting back on its feet after surviving decades of pollution from heavy industry. Soon we'll be polluted all over again, but this time by our own government. A group of citizens formed to fight this diesel plan and push for electric trains. They call themselves the Clean Train Coalition, and it was their campaign that made me realize how serious this issue is. They are organized, smart, and determined that the citizens get the correct information.
We got a little bit of information through the web where we started digging up that Metrolinx had this fairly significant plan to intensify diesel train traffic along the corridor that really sits cuts across our neighborhood. And what a few of us proposed was a better way to organize was not just within our neighborhood, but across neighborhoods. And so what we proposed was the gathering of representatives of different communities up and down the rail tracks with the idea that by working together, we could achieve more than we could if we were split up.
Nobody is building diesel anything. There are places where there is diesel regional rail that they're converting to electric because they realize it's gotta. In England, they're about to embark on some big projects to convert and electrify huge, the line between London and Swansea in Wales is going to be electrified in the next couple of years. And that's, 275 kilometers of rail, and it's going to cost £1.2 billion. How is it we can only electrify 31 kilometers for the same amount of money? And India is in the process of converting their diesel train stock into electric. They're already at 30%. We have 2% in Canada.
A careful observer can use a respect scale to find how many citizens get an even break. As a community moves towards despotism, respect is restricted to fewer people.
Part of this rail expansion includes a grade separation. That means sinking the commuter rail line underneath the freight rail line where they cross. To do this job, Metrolinx has to drive over 2,000 piles into the ground.
They've started as early as 7:30 in the morning, it would start, and the house would literally shake. If we had a cup of coffee sitting on the table, it would start to walk across the table. The walls were shaking, the floor was shaking, all the furniture stuff was falling off of the shelves. I think they very quickly had a problem with the community here, and they were sending out teams of people. There were some young students, they looked like university students, and they were coming around, and they would bring us, you know, like this. They would bring us these headphones, which, you know, was a very nice gesture, I will say, but it doesn't stop the house shaking.
Even though there was a lot of studies that were done on this thing, caught a lot of people by surprise, a lot of the engineers by surprise. And because of that, we've actually gone down the corridor and done very extensive tests to find out, is this unique? And it is unique. It's really because of where the glacial lake used to be and the shoreline and, you know, how the sands all came together. We know that through Weston and through Strawn, where we still have to do quite a bit of piling, the soil conditions there really will allow us to auger the piles in the ground. So you're literally just drilling holes and putting in the piles. I wish we didn't have to do it this way. I mean, it's not like we've gone in and said, well, we're really pleased to do this, but we didn't want it to happen.
And I'm the owner of Diggity Dog and Lonesome Kitty. It's a canine and feline hotel. I've been here for 8 years, almost 9 years. I feel almost like I'm being held hostage here because of all the damage to my house. And I actually had my house for sale, the business and the house for sale, and I wanted to relocate. And of course I can't sell my house in the condition it's in. I think they've treated me sort of carefully after the first while because they realized that this was serious. As alarming as it was, it seemed like they almost knew that this was going to happen. Somebody knew about it. Somebody, they had to know.
But Metrolinx did have a choice. There are other technologies available to drive piles, like this Geiken press, that makes about as much noise as a lawnmower and causes no vibration. Instead, they chose the cheapest method. Diesel hammers. Any large transit project needs to have an environmental assessment done. This includes looking at health impacts on the people affected by the plan and consulting with those residents. In 2008, the McGuinty government truncated the process for environmental assessments. What previously took 3 years now had to be completed within 6 months. The Georgetown expansion was one of the first transit projects to use this new method.
If you ask the consultants and Metrolink staff at the community meetings basic questions, what would this cost? The answers vary from meeting to meeting, substantially, by an order of magnitude in some cases. You talk to them about the feasibility of electrification, and one guy will tell you one day, well, there's no such thing as an electric car that would fit on our tracks. And then you go and demonstrate that, yes, there's something off the shelf, and they say, oh, I didn't know about that. So clearly Metrolinx didn't follow the requirement of the process, which is to do all that good work and present it to the public and then run the six-month process. I think that they've scuttled what could have been a good compromise between transparency and expeditiousness and ruined it for everybody.
This environmental assessment specifically excluded electrification. They were not allowed to look at electrification as a possibility. So of course they can't come out in favor of electrification from the environmental and health perspective because they weren't even allowed to look at it. So there is no question that electric trains are better for human health. Even their consultants admit that. They're just not allowed to talk about it.
Most of us have a fair bit of control over the food we eat, the water we drink, and even the amount of sun that hits our skin. But we cannot control the air we breathe. And because the air is invisible, we tend to think it's harmless.
This is Medrol, 4 milligram tablets. These are steroids I have to take twice a day. Their side effects are osteoporosis, thinning of the bones, and anxiety, loss of sleep. This is one of the inhalers, well known among asthmatics, Pulmicort. It's steroidal. This is the Oxys, and this is Singulair, another oral pill that I take. Well, these medications run into the thousands of dollars combined per year. OHIP will not cover this, no. They don't, this is not covered. What is covered is medical appointments that are non-surgical. They will obviously, it goes under OHIP. So my doctor's appointments and my respirologist appointments are covered, but medication is not.
Ah! This is a GO train, it's not a diesel train! Train. It doesn't look very much like one.
The lungs are certainly developing all through kids' lifetime until they're full size. I mean, the lungs are growing and developing. So anything that impacts that could delay that development. And so the lungs may have some long-term effect from it. And there are numerous studies in the literature that shows that air pollution exposure early in life has been shown to have delayed development in lungs, so that these kids either take longer or maybe not even ever get full lung development and full capacity, depending on the exposure to air pollution.
The government and Metrolinx were doing a lot of verbal tap dancing with the public. Residents claimed Metrolinx was either dishonest or incompetent, their community consultations were a sham, and that they were trying to dismiss the health risks involved with their diesel plans. People's concerns were not being heard, so the Clean Train Coalition organized a demonstration. Residents formed a human train that marched along the rail corridor through the affected neighborhoods.
have a little girl who's particularly susceptible to this diesel exhaust, and that's the particular, that's the scary part for me. But it's a much bigger issue than that in terms of, it's one of those issues that just seems like it should be so obvious that in the 21st century, we should not be running expanded diesel trains through a dense urban corridor. So this isn't just about the neighborhoods, it's about the city. And this is an issue that I just felt like I've got to jump in and do something. I'm not an activist, this is the first time I've done it.
That when it's smoggy, when we have a bad air day, more people have symptoms, more people go to the doctor, more people take medication, more people are admitted to hospital, and yes, more people die than on days when the air is clear. Each year in Toronto, about 6,000 people are admitted to hospital, and 1,700 people die prematurely as a result of air pollution. Any proposal which has the potential to make our air quality worse should pass a very stringent test before it goes forward. And so far, the Metrolinx proposal has not passed that test, in my view.
And then I heard a neighbor of mine on the microphone. He made an ominous announcement.
That's okay, Scott Dobson, Junction Triangle. We have a little bit of an announcement. You always have this happen at these kinds of events, but someone's gone missing. We need a little bit of help here. So Junction Triangle people would like, if anyone has seen Tony Ruprecht, could you please help him find his way back to the Junction Triangle to help us out? We could really use some help.
I heard Tony was making an appearance at a local residence group, so I showed up with a camera.
That is a silly, that's a really silly argument in your mind.
And if this is the fight of your life and we're all in this together, you're going to sit there and take the paycheck, but not make any noise about it. You're going to sit in caucus and quietly behind the scenes, and you're going to say it's Mr. Pritchard, and Mr. Pritchard's going to say it's you.
You guys hold the purse strings. You say it's all about money. You had a billion to waste at eHealth. Right? That would be the difference between diesel and electric. That $1 billion, you wasted at eHealth. And yet there's not enough money for the residents here in the community. So why don't you, if you're really that adamant about it, and you're with us, go to the premier and say, look, either you electrify this, or I'm going to sit as an independent. Come on. Like, you're with us. Like, put it on the table. Let's see the cards. Let's see some fight. We see nothing but silence.
You got a good point, plus it's a silly argument, both.
Well, you can dismiss it as a silly argument, but look, there's an option there for you.
Let me answer.
Really put the fight into it.
Anyway, the point is that if I were to do that, I'd have to do that with many issues, not be silly, because that'd be
a
one-shot deal.
One,
I would be a one-shot person, and I'd be out of not only out of the party, but I'd be out of caucus, and that would be the end of it.
And before I go, maybe we should just have some quick ideas of how you can help to maintain us on the front burner from the community's point of view. Is that a good question? So I think whoever organized along the train track, with 1,000 people, who organized
rally.
That rally for 1,000 people? Who was the organizer?
The Human Train. The Clean Train Coalition organized the Human Train.
Okay, Clean Train Coalition. Okay. So, you have to keep that up.
What are you going to do now, Tony? How are you going to be proactive?
Hello. I guess you didn't hear me just now, what I just said.
No, he said he wants me.
We're going to work this out together.
You see those papers in Tony's hand? They are information packages he handed out at the meeting. And on top of those packages was the same letter he keeps referring to. At the time of this meeting, it was 7 months old. He couldn't even be bothered to update it. I guess I can't expect too much from Tony. He only makes about 4 times more than most residents in his riding. I was introduced to Jamie Burko, a journalism student at Ryerson who was doing an article on this story. Like me, he had a lot of barriers, behind which were people who didn't want to talk.
And Rob Pritchard's office, not a politician, but very unhelpful, so he might as well have been a politician. And yeah, it's a sad, sad list of people who just will not ever talk to me about this story or really any other, I assume. The number one thing I learned is that government officials do not like talking to journalists about anything. It doesn't matter if it's the most basic question of all. I mean, I've actually asked direct questions to say, are you the person who deals with, like, are you the person I would be talking to about this? And I'd get 16 different answers. It's remarkable the skill that goes into evasion, really.
Just a few days before the environmental assessment was about to begin, the government of Ontario fired the board of Metrolinx. That board consisted primarily of elected officials, and it was replaced with private sector appointees. Mayor David Miller was on the original board.
The people who are experts in public transit and planning, and they're connected. Right? Transportation and planning are intrinsically connected. People who are experts in that are the mayor, the chairs of the regions, and the chair of the TTC and the chair of the planning committee in the City of Toronto, by definition, because that's what you do. And from my perspective, when the province got rid of elected officials from the board, it was a very negative thing, and it makes the board quite unaccountable. You know, if I have a conversation, for example, with somebody who wants to sell something to the city, it's open and public, and it's recorded in the lobbyist registry. Who knows who the board of Metrolinx is talking to? What are their self-interests?
Primarily designed to keep the people out, to keep accountability out, and to keep people from knowing what they're doing. They don't have to account to anybody. So again, we've seen with e-health what that looks like. We've seen what happens when you know, you give something to a group of consultants or a group of people who are not accountable to anybody until the auditor gets there and it all blows up. This is not a good model. It hasn't worked before, and here we have it, and it's clearly not working now.
In the spring of 2009, the Liberal government chose Robert Pritchard to head Metrolinx. Mr. Pritchard has no experience running a public transit agency. In fact, he only recently rode a GO train for the first time to visit his farm. In 1984, a local school group was skating on this rink. A toxic gas was released by a nearby industry, and five children, two teachers, and the rink employee fell sick for several days. They complained of dizziness, headaches, burning eyes, nose, and throat, and vomiting.
Stop it! I'm trying to teach Asha how to skate.
I actually went back.
Today, the industries are gone, and families skate here without anxiety. But this rink is only 20 feet from one of the rail lines. If you came over to my place for a coffee or a pickle, you would see Nellie's drawings all over the house. She draws on anything and everything.
I draw on paper and styrofoam, dog dishes, and wood, and sidewalk, and windows with my window markers.
And she loves to draw
mermaids, and fairies, and dogs, and princesses, and kids. And she and mummies with babies.
Ever since the Human Train March, she started to make her own polite anti-diesel posters.
Fairies can stop the diesel trains.
Could they? Do you know any fairies?
I'll give them a note.
Well, this picture is about stopping diesel trains. Because if you ride diesel trains and smoke, this is what happens.
What's that?
You get a mask, and that helps you breathe.
What's the K for? Narrow K?
No, now. Silent K.
Oh.
This poster will stop. Diesel trains won't it, Dad.
Should we send it to the Premier of Ontario, Dalton McGuinty?
Send it to the politicians.
Okay. Should we send it to all of them?
Yeah.
You think they'll listen?
Because they don't listen to grown-ups, they listen to kids.
I heard Mario Silva would be attending a community meeting, so I showed up again with a camera.
Not, but there's a feeling that what they're doing is right, and that they do believe that this is a good project, and it's better for the community, and so it's very hard to, in fact.
But which community this is what? I get the standard letter back from the province saying, you know, thank you, we've heard your concerns, and that's it. I get nothing else from them. They don't get involved, they don't talk to us, and so they may feel this is good and right, but I'm saying, for who? For 905? For the link to, you know, I mean, the airport? No one has talked to us about what's good for us. And what I'd like to see someone like you do, who represents us, is be a voice for us, because it seems like my voice doesn't count. I need you to actually say to somebody in the provincial government, why don't you talk to the people here?
But I think the city, more than anybody else, they have executive powers. If the city was asked for some type of act, was the one that was filing the injunction, would have been a different story.
We're tired of fixing our neighborhood. So many volunteer hours have been put into it. People work. You know, this is not their job. And we are sick and tired and going to be sicker in the future. So we want you guys, the three of you, to play well. And we want you to cross the threshold and invite Adam to a meeting. And David Miller. And whoever else you know that has to be at that table. I don't know. I'm just throwing darts in the air and inviting whoever I can and screaming at whoever I can.
That one of the things I think I like to see coming out of here that you know, is a meeting with the new minister. See if we can also get together.
Mario tried to deflect responsibility and blame the city, but the people in the room knew better. He did try, though, to set up a meeting with the new Minister of Transportation, Kathleen Wynne. The meeting never happened. The final stage of the environmental assessment is a review of the project by the Minister of the Environment. The minister approved the project with conditions, the main one being that the trains would have to use Tier 4 emission controls on their locomotives. The trouble is, the way the condition is worded, it only applies to about half the trains. The other caveat is that Tier 4 must be used when it becomes commercially available. That's because Tier 4 doesn't exist yet. Now, electric trains, for example, have been ready for over 100 years. This electric monorail in Seattle opened in 1962. They figured it out half a century ago. Here in Ontario, we have to look at old film clips to see what the future could be.
From the very start of this project, the first thing Metrolinx said was, oh, we're building new service for the GO people who live up in Brampton and Georgetown and Milton. This is badly needed expansion for them, which I believed until I realized that they don't need four tracks to do it. The reason they're at capacity is because the trains aren't long enough or there aren't enough trains in the mornings. That's not the reason for this build. So what is the reason for this build? Well, it's for the airport rail link. It turns out the air rail link is included in the bid book for Toronto to have won the Pan Am Games. If Toronto hadn't won the bid for the Pan Am Games, there wouldn't be this urgency. and we would have more leeway for 1 or 2 years for them to study and study again, which they don't need to do, but to study to prove that this is the right way to go.
But at the same time, I know that it is going to cost in the billions of dollars to electrify the system, and governments only have so much money. So the real question for us is, what do we, not only Go Transit, but we as a society have to give up in order to electrify? That ultimately is a decision that the politicians have to make.
Power scale is another important yardstick of despotism. It gauges the citizen's share in making the community's decisions. Communities which concentrate decision-making in a few hands rate low on a power scale and are moving towards despotism.
Here for Dalton McGinty. We'll take it right up to him if we could.
I have to speak to security.
Okay. Hi there.
Hi.
We have a letter here for Dalton McGinty.
Oh, okay. Unfortunately, you can't just bring the mailer to his office. You actually have to bring it to the mail trailer back. It has to be screened and everything.
You can't go in there?
No.
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 Come on, we'll go to the mail trailer.
Queen Victoria.
Yeah.
This.
How are you, sir?
I'm well, how are you?
Good, thanks. You want to shut that camera off?
No.
Get it out of my face?
Okay, it's out of your face.
Okay. Can you turn it off, please?
No.
Are you familiar with the Trespass Property Act? Do you have authorization to do this?
Sure.
Okay, who's this young lady?
It's my daughter.
How do I know that?
I don't know.
Okay. You want to shut the camera off, please?
No.
Okay. Then I'm going to ask you to leave.
This is public property.
I'm going to ask you to leave, sir.
While the sergeant and I argued, Nellie watched a hawk that flew into a nearby tree.
I'm
going to ask you to leave the property. You understand that?
Upon checking the Trespass Act, it turns out I was allowed to film, and the sergeant had to escort us to the mail trailer, which wasn't really there. But Nellie delivered her letter regardless.
Sorry to start off.
This is Nellie.
Nellie, nice to meet you. Sorry to start off in a bad way like we did.
It's down here now? It's not a trailer. Okay.
No. What's your stuff, Nellie?
So can I film this bit?
At my school, I have...
I'd rather you not.
Oh, really?
You got it already, right? That's fine. Good enough.
Okay.
Shut it off.
Okay. Well, they're not used to people like you and I coming in and with cameras trying to give a letter to Dalton McGinty.
But I didn't fluster his day.
No.
It was you.
Yeah. I think, you know what? I think he likes you.
And you.
Do you think Dalton McGinty will phone us? Think he might call house asking for you?
Bye, Queens Park.
Well, Dalton didn't call or write, but he held firm to his decision to give us another generation of diesel trains just in time for a two-week sporting event called the Pan Am Games. So what happens now to Nikki Needles and Nellie Noodles and all our neighbors in all the neighborhoods along the corridor? The already polluted air we breathe will soon get worse. The cost of electrification will continue to rise and become the burden of our children. And in the meantime, Toronto will be known as the diesel capital of the world.